have never before met a Vulcan, sir.
Nor I a work of art, madam.
The Cloudminders, I wanted to do a serious story, a very serious story.
Dick, imbecile, will die!
There was a lot of discussion going on about haves and have-nots, and I thought, what a wonderful metaphor if we have this city in the sky.
Stratos, Captain. City actually floating in the sky.
And that's where all of the nobles live, and then down below on the planet, thousands of feet below, where there'd be a big pressure difference in the atmospheric pressure, would be all of the grunts, the workers. And that was the story I pitched, and they loved it. And I wanted it to have a kind of a downer ending in that we didn't overthrow the whole government and fix the whole world just by one visit, that all we'd done is make one change, and maybe these people would fix it themselves. And the way I wrote it, McCoy's line at the end is, yes, but how many children are going to die in the meantime? And that was too much of a downer for the producer then. So he brought in Margaret Armin to rewrite it, and it got turned into, well, if we'll just wear gas masks and watch out for xenite gas, we can just be happy little slaves working in the mines.
They will be very effective, sir. They've been severely tested, and the troglites will no longer suffer from retardation and emotional difficulties.
They will all be like her, ungrateful, vindictive.
Yes, our demands have just begun.
I wasn't happy with that. I didn't feel that was true to the nature of Star Trek challenging and making you think.
And Uhura, whose name means freedom. She walks in beauty like the night.
It was after the first year in the show, and I really missed my work in theater and what I wanted to be. And I didn't feel that my role in the show was going anywhere or really meant anything. I really didn't see it, the big picture, yet. I went in and told Gene Roddenberry I was going to leave the show, and he really begged me not to. He said, take the weekend and think about it. And I said, okay, but I really mean to do this. And that weekend, someone up there saw fit to intercede, because I went to a fundraiser, I think it was NAACP fundraiser, and someone said someone wanted to meet me, who was a big fan of mine. I turned and looked into the face of Dr. Martin Luther King. This wonderful beatific face who smiled and said, I'm one of your biggest fans. And he said, do you know that your show is one of the only shows my wife and I let our little children see?
Mr. Sulu, prepare to move in on the Romulan vessel. Ship to ship, Uhura. Put this on the screen.
Hailing frequencies open, sir.
I thanked him and said I was leaving the show. His face became stern and he said, you cannot. You cannot do this. Don't you understand who you are and what you mean? That this man has given a legacy to the world that changes the face of television forever. And that is because you are there and he has created what I am fighting for. Men and women going forth in peaceful exploration of different colors, different races, as equals. You are as important on that show as any other person on there.
Well, Uhura, you're the only one who can do it.
He said, don't you know you have the first non-stereotypical role on television? You cannot leave because that door has only opened a little bit and you're there. If you leave, that door can close, and who knows how long it will take. And he said, images. And it's not just for our little children to see you there. It is for people who don't look like us to see us as equals. you have to say. And I said, yes, sir. And I did.